Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Kate Andrews and I am Education Support Officer for Biology here at SSERC. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this afternoon's SSERCmeet, live from the SSERC Broadcasting Studio. We have teachers from all over Scotland joining us this afternoon. There are people from Dumfries and Galloway in the south to Highland and Aberdeen in the north, and from Glasgow and from Edinburgh and from lots of places in between. With me here are Alan Purvis, who is Technical Support Person. Paul Beaumont, Head of Section for Biology and Chemistry, might join us at some point, but he's got some various things that he's got to attend to at the moment. And of course, I've got Professor Leonis with me here too. The way the SSERCmeet is going to work is that Lee will present her talk to you, and during or after that, you can send in any questions you might have for Lee via the chat pod. And after the lecture, Lee and I will have a short conversation around some questions that I have for her. But if you send in questions, then we can ask Lee those questions at that time as well. So it's my pleasure to welcome Lee here today. She is Director of Communications and a Principal Scientist at the Morden Research Institute. Morden, some of you may know, is based at the Pentland Science Park on the outskirts of Edinburgh. It is recognised worldwide for its contribution to research into infectious diseases of farmed livestock. However, work at Morden contributes to safeguarding human health too, as many of the pathogens that affect animals can also be transmitted to people. Lee's background is in immunology and in tropical animal health, and she has carried out research into infectious diseases of livestock and into control of diseases caused by protozoan parasites. And we're really delighted to welcome here today. Lee's worked collaboratively with SSERC to support biology teachers in various ways, including speaking to teachers at some of our residential courses. She has hosted teacher visits along with SSERC at Morden, and she has also delivered lectures to, for example, the Royal Society of Biology's annual teachers meeting. She's going to talk to us today about our relationship with parasites. And so thank you, Lee, for coming. And it's my pleasure to welcome you. Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's a real pleasure to be here this afternoon. And I hope you'll enjoy this presentation about parasites. Also, as Kate says, if there's any questions that you have at any point along the way, please do just type them in and we'll pick them up at the end. So what I'm going to talk about the next half hour is parasites. And the title of the talk is Public Enemy Number One, or Your New Best Friend. And the reason I've got this title is that some parasites, which we'll discuss, are quite harmful to you. And some parasites can actually help you overcome other diseases. And we'll go through that as we go through the talk. So what are parasites? Well, parasites are little animals that live inside or are attached to us or other animals, and they benefit by living inside us. They get nutrients from us and use us as their home, basically. And a good parasite generally will not kill its host. And usually when you have problems with parasites, it's because there's some imbalance there between the host-parasite relationship, and the parasite has not evolved alongside its host. So where you see disease, it's usually because the parasite is not familiar with its host. And a couple of examples we've got on the slide here. The one on the right is a tapeworm, and I hope none of you have ever experienced this personally, but these are very, very big worms that live inside your intestines. And the one we've got on the right, you'll be pleased it doesn't jump out of the screen at you, but they're pretty long. They can be many feet long. The other one is the head lice. Again, it's magnified a bit there, but some of you again may be familiar with this one. The picture I've got there of the little boy with the calf is something I'm going to talk about later on, which is zoonotic infections, which can be transmitted between animals and people. So host parasite relationships. Some of these can be dangerous with some severe diseases caused by parasites. Some, I would say, are more neutral, where the parasite infection isn't actually causing any harm to the host. And in some cases, they can actually be beneficial. And towards the end of the talk, I'm going to talk to you a bit about how they can actually benefit us with some new treatments. And we'll talk about the other two areas as well, giving you some examples of particular pathogens. So what I'm going to do in the first part of the talk is actually describe to you a sort of historical context of parasites. And some of you might not be aware, but Scottish scientists and explorers were responsible in large part for discovering some of the most important parasites, I say, worldwide. And I'll talk you through some of that. So David Livingstone, you're probably familiar with, that quite a famous Scottish scientist and explorer, did a lot of work in Africa and a lot of exploring in Africa. He was a doctor and he was very interested in disease and parasites in particular. He did a phenomenal journey when you think back to the conditions that, that the explorers were working in. Many of them went across to Africa and unfortunately died of tropical disease, a lot of these caused by parasites. But David Livingstone was extremely tough, very determined, and he travelled on foot, you know, 30,000 miles across Africa, which is quite phenomenal. And during the time he was there, he became very interested in malaria, and particularly looking for cures or treatments for malaria. And today, malaria afflicts a large number, many millions of people. I think a lot of people have heard quite a lot about malaria, particularly a problem for young children. And they are very, very susceptible to infection. The parasite is transmitted by mosquitoes. And this is a picture here on the screen you can see of the stage in the red blood cells. And when the parasite gets into the red blood cells, when they erupt, the parasite can come out of the red blood cells. And this is what often causes the fever in people when you get this stage in the red blood cells. It's transmitted by mosquitoes. And that's why if you're ever traveling, you probably get a lot of warning about trying to cover up and avoid bites by mosquitoes. In the mosquito, the parasite can develop, and then when the mosquito takes a blood meal, it will transmit the parasite into you, and that's what causes the disease. And what David Livingstone did, actually, he was very interested in looking at cures or preventions, and I don't know if you can read what's on the bottle there very effectively. I haven't got my glasses on, but I think it's quinine and rhubarb. Kate's nodding at me. So what he had done, in fact, in speaking to some of the local people, they often use tree barks to create medicines for a lot of tropical diseases. And in fact, the Maasai people in Africa, they still use bark from certain trees to create medicines to protect against certain diseases. And this is one that David Livingstone had worked on, with his friend Henry Wellcome, and this was used as a treatment for malaria. And one of the things, I think one of the derivatives there, chloroquine, is something that is used as a prophylactic against malaria. One of the big issues I think we've got with treating some of these diseases is in using drugs as therapeutics, is that the parasites will develop resistance to a lot of the drugs. And this is a major problem, I think, worldwide, not just in malaria, but you know, other treatments for infectious diseases. So it's quite important we use the drugs that we have effectively and also understand how drug resistance will be taking place. Malaria is something that has, as you probably are all aware, has caused a lot of interest with people. And it is a disease of poverty. There is quite a lot people can do to prevent the disease. And some very, very famous people at Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and Bono's there in front of Time magazine, but really for their work in promoting, raising awareness of malaria and also putting a lot of money in to try and prevent malaria. But it's still one of the biggest killers of people worldwide. So another famous Scot was Sir Ronald Ross, and he won a Nobel Prize actually, and he showed the link between mosquitoes and malaria. And this is quite an interesting page I just wanted to show you. This is a page out of his original notebook. And what's really nice, I don't know if you can see the little drawings there, but this is some of the work he did where he was describing the different life cycle stages of malaria. And there's some beautiful drawings there. And his notebook, I think, is preserved at the Wellcome Museum in London. But it shows that these people did very, very detailed work looking down microscopes and trying to piece together what the life cycle of some of these parasites are, and most importantly, how they were transmitted to people. And once you understand that host-parasite interaction, and if you look at different transmission routes, you can work out where the vulnerability is of the parasite, and that's where you would try and intervene if you're looking at control strategies. So the next person I've talked about is Patrick Manson, and he's often described as the father of tropical medicine. He comes from Old Meldrum in Aberdeenshire. I think Kate said there were some people on from Aberdeen today, so he is from near Aberdeen. And he was the youngest son in a farming family. And in those days, I think the older sons would have inherited the farm, and he was sent off to seek his fortune in the tropics. And he, again, was very, very interested in parasites, infectious disease, and really because a lot of the people that were sent out to far-flung places in the world unfortunately succumbed to a lot of infectious diseases, so he was very, very interested in finding out a bit more about it. This is a rather nasty disease caused by a filarial worm, and it's called elephantiasis. You may have seen pictures of this. It's really not very nice. What happens here is this is an example of where you've got an imbalance of the host and the parasite. And what happens with the parasite is that the person will make a response, an immune response to the parasite, and creates all the influx of fluid you can see in the lymph vessels of this poor person's leg. It's a nasty disease. It can be treated quite effectively with drugs, and some of the drug companies are now donating drugs free to people to try and help them, but it still affects millions of people worldwide. It's caused by this little worm, a filarial worm. You can see it in the picture there, the little thread-like things, that's the worm. These are red blood cells beside it to give you an idea of the size difference between the worm and the blood cells. Now, Patrick Manson was quite interested in science and medicine, and what he did, which would be probably quite unethical today, is he did experiments with his gardener, and that's his gardener, unfortunately, there behind the mesh, and what he was doing was trying to work out how the filarial worms were being transmitted, and he had some mosquitoes in a jar, and he picked up the infection from his gardener by letting the mosquitoes bite him. I say not very ethical, but quite effective, because he found out that in actual fact the worms were transmitted by mosquitoes. And again, that was very helpful in trying to find out how you could prevent the infection. So Patrick Manson came back and set up the School of Tropical Medicine in London, and he was responsible for many other discoveries in the field of tropical medicine. Well worth a visit if you're in London to go down to the tropical school. So sleeping sickness is one, again, you've possibly heard of, transmitted again by tsetse flies, affects people and animals, and there are most people that get the infection become very sick and they can go into a coma, and usually they die. It's quite a nasty disease. We work a bit with this disease in cattle as well, and it's quite a severe infection. There are some therapeutics you can use against this disease, but they tend to be very, very toxic. They are based on arsenic, which it itself is quite toxic. And this parasite is really clever. You've possibly heard of this, but they're also very beautiful. You can see the little purple shape there. The red thing on the slide there is a red blood cell, just again to give you an idea of the size of them. But this parasite avoids the immune response by changing its surface coat. So on the surface it will have certain molecules called, we call them antigens, And when the immune response tries to attack the parasite will just shed off all these antigens and almost put on another coat. And that's how it disguises itself from the immune response. And that's why it's incredibly difficult to make a vaccine against trypanosomes. And that's why most of the treatments are based on therapeutics. There's some very interesting work going on at the moment in Dundee, trying to get some new drugs to treat people and animals with sleeping sickness. So David Bruce was involved in a bit of the research on trying to understand sleeping sickness. And again, he has got some beautiful pictures. This is from his notebook taken in the 1800s when he was describing the blood stages. And I think you can see, if you remember back to the picture that showed you of the trypanosomes before, you can see he's really captured that in his notebook, describing the different stages. Oops, I've just gone on one too fast. So I'm going to move on to that's the history bit over, but I thought you might be interested in that in terms of the contribution that a lot of Scottish people have made to understanding some of the major parasitic diseases we face at the moment. I'm going to, in this middle section of the talk to you about a parasite a bit closer to home called Toxoplasma gondii. And the reason I'm using this as an example to you, it's really to show the host-parasite interaction and how in different hosts the same parasite may be harmful, it may be neutral, it's not quite beneficial, but it has quite a different reaction depending on the different host species. I'm not sure if any of you have heard of this parasite or not, but it is the most successful parasite in the world. It infects all warm-blooded animals, including ourselves. And this slide here is just giving you a sort of range of the different hosts that the parasite will infect. And up on the left-hand side, I've got a picture of wallabies there. And these animals are very, very vulnerable to infection with toxoplasma. And we think that's because they have evolved away from the parasite. The definitive host of the parasite is the cat, and the cat was not introduced to Australia until about 300 years ago. So these animals, marsupials, evolved away from the cat, and if they encounter toxoplasma in zoos and things, they can die of acute infection. They just do not have resistance to it. I've got sheep there in the middle, and this is a species that we work on at Morden, as we're quite interested in the veterinary health of animals. And the parasite can cause abortion in sheep. If the sheep catches it for the first time when they're pregnant, the parasite can cause abortion. This is also the case with people. So if women catch the parasite for the first time they're pregnant, the parasite can infect the developing fetus and the baby can be born blind or deaf or brain damaged. So it's quite an important parasite that pregnant women need to obviously avoid. I've got cattle up in the right-hand side, and these animals can get infected with the parasite, but they don't tend to develop disease. So there's quite a wide spectrum of clinical signs depending on the host parasite reaction. The bottom two pictures I've got there is pictures of cats and mice, and the one in the middle is probably the more normal one of the cat chasing the mouse. And then you've got one where the mouse is sitting on top of the cat, which is not so normal. And this is some very interesting work that was done in Oxford, where they looked at behavioural differences in mice that were infected with toxoplasma. The parasite, once you are infected, it tends to go up to your brain and it goes to other tissues in the body. And what we think the parasite is doing is it's changing the behaviour of the mouse because it wants the mouse to be caught by the cat. And if the cat catches the mouse and eats it, the parasite will be transmitted to the cat. So it's quite interesting. I think it raised a lot of interest in people who might be infected, wondering what it might be doing in our brains. So we'll push on with that. So what is the impact of this parasite? Quite a big impact in the veterinary world and in human medicine. It's a major cause of abortion in sheep and goats, and this is the site of research we're doing at Morden. It's the second most important cause of abortion in sheep in the UK, and also it occurs in many other countries across the world. As I mentioned before, in women it can be a problem if they catch the parasite for the first time during pregnancy, and the babies can be born if they are infected with eye disease or brain damage. And this results in quite a big impact because the congenitally infected children will have lifelong learning disabilities, which is a real problem. The incidence of toxins is not that high, I'm glad to see, in terms of congenital infection. In UK, it's about 5 cases per 100,000 births. In Brazil, where we're also doing some research, it's much higher. It's 5 in 1,000 births. And we think this is because there are different strains of toxoplasma in Brazil that are much more virulent than the strains we're getting in the UK. And that's an area we're keeping an eye on, because we obviously don't want any of these strains to come across to the UK. Other vulnerable groups are immunocompromised people, cancer patients or transplant patients. And this is because the parasite, if you have a good normal immune system, that will normally keep the parasite in check following infection. But if your immune system is at all compromised, particularly with T-cells are very important in immunity to it, the parasite can become active again and cause disease. So immunocompromised people are quite a vulnerable group. The picture I've got on the bottom corner there, there is a small, it's basically a cross-section through the retina of an eye. And the sort of darker purple bit, I don't know if I can use the mouse to, no, I probably can't. The darker purple bit in the middle is a cyst of, oh, thank you, is a cyst of the parasite. It's just that, yeah, thank you very much. That is the parasite cyst. So that is a cross-section of a retina of someone who has got toxoplasma causing pathology in the eye. And this is coming up quite a lot, particularly in South America with some of these more virulent strains. So the global impact of toxoplasma is really very, very high. Now, this is just to introduce the parasite. Was one of the only parasites, as far as I know, who got the front 5 pages of The Independent a few years ago. And this was because of the interest by the Food Standards Agency. And they became concerned about the prevalence of toxoplasma in the food chain. Because as I mentioned to you before, it's a parasite that can affect all warm-blooded animals, so that would be including food animals. And one of the major routes of transmission is to eat undercooked meat that is infected with this parasite. And what the Food Standards Agency were concerned about was that they didn't know the prevalence of the parasite in food animals. So they were looking for studies to be done on that. And also they were very interested in whether you might be able to vaccinate food animals against the parasite to make meat safer for people to eat. So looking at the transmission of the parasite, the definitive host is the cat. And the cat is the only animal where the sexual cycle of the parasite will take place. And on the diagram on the right-hand side of the screen, where you can see these, it looks blue, and then there's these little green banana shapes. That's an electron micrograph of a cross-section of a gut of a cat that is infected with a parasite. And the green banana things are the toxoplasma parasites developing in the gut of the cat. And as a result of that, the cat, when it becomes infected, will shed millions of what we call oocysts. These are the egg stage of the parasite. The diagram at the bottom underneath the cat, that's an oocyst of toxoplasma. And I don't know if you can see, but on the outside, there's quite a distinct cell wall there. And that helps the parasite survive in the environment. These things are tiny, though. To give you an idea of the size, you could probably get about 100,000 of them on the head of a pin. They're really small. Now, that stage of the parasite, once the cat becomes infected, and it's usually young cats that go hunting for the first time, might eat a mouse or a bird that is infected with toxo. They become infected, the parasite will multiply in the gut of the cat, and then they will shed these egg stages into the environment. And they will last in the environment for quite a long time, and they are a source of infection for animals and for people. So to summarise the transmission route of the parasite, the ways you can catch it, you can either catch it by eating accidentally these zoosis, the egg stage from contaminated food or water, and that's how a lot of herbivores and sheep will pick it up as well. Another way, which is very common in people, is to consume undercooked meat. So that would be from food animals that are infected with toxo, and if the meat's not cooked properly, the cyst stage of the parasite, if you eat it, you will become infected. The pictures I've got on the left-hand side there show a picture of the egg stage at the top. The middle one, which again is the green, these are just fluorescently labelled parasites, show how the parasite multiplies in cells. The parasite gets into the cell, and you can see that that cell is stuffed full of parasite tachyzoites. That cell will burst open, and the released little green parasites will go and find another cell, get inside it, multiply, and it keeps going in that cycle until the immune system can basically catch up with it and stop it multiplying. The picture I've got at the bottom there, the bottom left-hand side, is a picture of a cyst, and this is the stage of the parasite that will persist inside you or animals that get infected. It's not as big as that, you'll be pleased to hear. That is, again, much magnified. But inside that cyst, there are thousands and thousands of parasites. And we think that once you become infected with a parasite, you will be infected for life, as the parasite will stay inside these cysts inside you. So sorry, the other important way you can get infected is vertical transmission. So that would happen if a pregnant woman gets infected, the parasite would be transmitted to the unborn baby. Same with animals, that's how the infection can be transmitted to offspring. So foodborne toxoplasma. Most people pick up an infection from eating undercooked meat. And we've been doing some work looking at the fact that outdoor reared food animals are much more likely to be infected than indoor reared animals. There's a bit of a fashion to rear outdoor reared pigs particularly, and it's very good for welfare, but the unintended consequence of that is they may pick up infection from the environment, and pig meat is quite likely, outdoor pig meat particularly, is more likely to be infected with toxo than indoor. Looking at the impact of this again, I don't know if you've heard of a term called disability adjusted life years, but this is a measure of impact. And when people are looking at the importance or the impact of a lot of different foodborne diseases, toxoplasma actually emerged as one of the most important ones. And that's really because of although the incidence is low, the severity, if you have a congenitally infected child, is extremely high. And that's why it's now emerging as one of the most important foodborne pathogens. We did a survey of livestock based on the call I was talking to you about earlier that came out of the Food Standards Agency. We did do some research looking at what was the prevalence of this parasite in livestock, and we looked at 125 sheep flocks all across Scotland. There's a diagram there on the left-hand side of the slide, which shows where the farms were. And we found that there was extensive environmental contamination because we found toxoplasma in all the sheep flocks we looked at. And because sheep are herbivores, they're obviously picking up from the environment. Another prevalence study was done in pigs in the UK, not done by us, done by other people, I think it was DEFRA, showed that about 7% of UK pigs were positive for toxoplasma. So another study that's ongoing at the moment, just to let you be aware of, is looking at the prevalence of the parasite in livestock species across Europe. And this is a study that's involved seven European countries, about 40 participants and 12 organisations. We've looked at different species, cattle, sheep, pigs, chickens and horses. I know we don't tend to eat horses in the UK, but they do in the continent. We certainly don't need to eat horses in the UK. Sometimes we do it by accident. And what part of this project was to look at what was the prevalence and also for us to use exactly the same tests in the different countries so we could compare the results. We were also interested in looking at whereabouts in the food animals was the parasite more likely to be present. So the parasite is also quite prevalent in wildlife and the environment. And we have looked at some wild carnivores in Scotland, foxes and badgers, weasels, ferrets and stoats. And what we've done there is just looked at what was the prevalence. And we were also very interested in looking at what type, what was the genotype. So we're looking at the strains of toxoplasma. Because back to what I was saying about the difference in virulence of the parasite, some strains in South America are highly virulent and can cause disease in immunocompetent people, whereas some of the strains we picked up so far in the UK and Europe have been less virulent. But what we wanted to do is, as carnivores are good sentinels or indicators of what's in the environment, we did some work genotyping samples from them. We also were looking at Eustis contamination in water supplies, which we've done in Scotland, and found that in certain water supplies there is the presence of T. gondii Eustis. And these can only come from cats, which is quite interesting. So it just shows the widespread contamination of the environment by Eustis coming from infected cats. There's another interesting study done over in America that you might have heard of, but it was looking at what was killing California sea otters. And these are a protected species. And they were dying off what looked like toxoplasma. And I think a lot of the vets and scientists were quite confused about how the otters were actually getting infected, because as you know, they live in the oceans, and as far as we know, cats don't. And what they discovered was that, in fact, the main issues they were having with the sea otters was quite near the large urban areas like San Francisco and Los Angeles. And it turned out that what was happening was that cat owners were flushing cat feces down the toilets, and it was getting into the runoff and going into the oceans. It was being concentrated by shellfish. So the shellfish were filtering the water through the oocysts of the parasite were getting concentrated in the shellfish. The otters were eating the shellfish, and as a result, they were getting infected by toxoplasma, unfortunately. Now, this is maybe a good or bad example of this evolution and host-parasite interaction, because the sea mammals, sea otters, would not normally experience toxoplasma because they're not in contact with cats. But they were experiencing it through this contamination, but they had no resistance to it, so they were dying of the parasite. And it shows that when you get that imbalance where the parasite and the host are not, they haven't evolved together, that's often when you get quite serious disease. So what can we do about it? Now, I've told you how awful it is and how dangerous it can be. What can we do about it? Well, we're working quite a lot at Morden on disease prevention and control strategies, particularly for livestock. But we're hoping that some of the research we're doing there will also be relevant for the human infection too. So we've been looking at vaccines to try and prevent congenital toxoplasma. So that would be to protect sheep against abortion due to the parasite. We're also now very interested in looking at vaccines to make food animals safer for human consumption, so to try and prevent the tissue cysts in the sheep as well. The holy grail here, I think the thing we'd really love to be able to do, is to create some sort of vaccine for cats, so that you could actually prevent the oocysts from being shed by the cat, because that's the stage that's really causing the problem in the environment. So I'll tell you a little bit about the disease in sheep. I apologise for the gory pictures there, but this is a picture of a sheep that caught toxoplasma in mid-pregnancy, and I don't know if you can see there, but the typical thing you see here is a stillborn lamb, and I don't know if you can see the placental structure under there, but there's a small mummified lamb just on the right-hand side. I don't know if Alan can find that in the with the pointer, but this is very, very typical pathology with toxoplasma. It's just on the right there. Thank you. It's just there. This is very typical. And what happens in the diagram below, I don't know if you can see that one. This is the placenta, which is in the diagram below. You can see there's a bit in the placenta which joins up the mother and the fetus in sheep, and it's called the cotyledon. The placental structure in people is slightly different, and you see a slightly different pathology in people. But with the sheep, I don't know if you can see on there, but there's tiny white spots on the cotyledon at the bottom. And that's caused, thanks Al, just these white spots there. That's caused really by the mother trying to fight the infection. So what will happen when the parasite gets into you or an animal, your immune system and their immune systems immediately start fighting it. And what happens in a pregnant animal is that the parasite gets into the placenta and it starts multiplying. And then what happens is the mother tries to fight that infection, and she inadvertently causes necrosis on the placenta. And that's what these little white spots are. They're areas of necrosis which is stopping the placenta working properly. This is probably what would happen in a pregnant woman as well. And this is what's causing the abortion and the death of the fetus. So the important thing to remember with toxoplasma is it's a primary infection in pregnancy that is causing the problem. And the stage of gestation is very important to the outcome. So the earlier in pregnancy the infection takes place, the more severe the disease. Later in pregnancy, the parasite will probably cross over into the fetus, but the fetus could be born alive, although congenital infected, and not show clinical signs. It's also, once the animal or person has been infected with the parasite, they do develop a very good protective immunity. And this is important if you're trying to develop vaccines or looking for control strategies. So I've got some good news for you now, having told you all this difficult stuff. There is a vaccine that has been developed. Initially, it was discovered in New Zealand. And we did some work in this Morden quite a few years ago to look at the efficacy of the vaccine in sheep. And this is a strain of the parasite that we call an incomplete strain. And that just means it won't go through a complete life cycle in the animal. And this is like your perfect vaccine, because what you really want in a vaccine is something that will stimulate the right protective immune response that will not cause harm to the animal and will not cause disease in the animal. These are the things you're trying to achieve. So this was a strain that was originally isolated in New Zealand. They used it as a vaccine for several years. It induces really, really good protective immunity and helps protect the sheep against abortion when you get infection. We tested it out at Morden, and we did a lot of work looking at protective immune responses, and it worked extremely well to protect sheep against this disease. And this is now the only commercially available vaccine in the world against toxoplasma. But it's been very important for us to use this vaccine and learn how it works. And hopefully that knowledge that we've got with that will help us develop other vaccines and perhaps even a human vaccine. So what we did was we took the same vaccine that I just talked about that will help prevent against congenital infection with toxo. And we used it to see if we could prevent that cyst stage. You were talking about that food animals can inadvertently transmit the disease to people if you eat undercooked meat. So we tested out the vaccine in pigs and sheep to see if we could actually stop the cysts being developed in the animals and therefore make the meat safer for human consumption. And to summarise that work, we were really pleased to discover that in fact the vaccine did significantly reduce the tissue cyst burden in both pigs and lambs, therefore making vaccinated animals, the meat from them would be safer to eat. We did look at where the parasite would disseminate to in particular tissues, and it certainly had a preference to go to the brain and the heart and the diaphragm more commonly than the edible muscle tissues that we would normally put into the food chain. So that was also very, very useful to know. But there are differences in, there will therefore be differences in infection risk depending on the tissue you're looking at. And the other thing, just to finish up this section on toxoplasma, is that we do a lot of work on prevention and control of the parasite using different outreach activities. Because I think a lot of people are unaware of the incidence of the parasite. We think about 1 in 5 people in Scotland are infected with it, and the older you are, the more likely you are infected. But I think people are unaware perhaps of the prevalence of the parasite in the population. It's a good example, I think, of different host parasite relationships depending on the host species as well. It's a good example, and it's one that we can all catch. So it's a good guess.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt you, but Jamie Irving from Elgin High School has asked a very relevant question at
yes,
the moment.
Yes,
so she's
course.
Asked, if you had toxoplasma in cyst form in you and you became immunocompromised, would it cause illness?
Yes. And that's a really good question. If I go back to, I don't know, I've got a picture of this. Yeah, that's a really good question. That on the top right-hand side, there's a picture of a cyst there. Alan's just about to, So what would happen is, because when you get infected with the parasite, you are infected for life, and under pressure of the immune system, the parasite will go into any chance to become immunocompromised, either through disease or treatment, the parasite will start becoming active again, and it will break open from that cyst and will come out and invade other cells. And in fact, back in the 1980s, toxoplasma was one of the major problems with AIDS patients before we got good antiretroviral therapies. A lot of AIDS patients were dying of toxoplasma encephalitis because the parasite would just erupt in the brain. There weren't good treatments. It's probably something I haven't covered yet. There are not very good drug treatments against toxo. So the parasite would cause a lot of disease. So you're absolutely right. It's kept in balance inside us because of our immune systems. And if you're any way compromised, it will start becoming active again. So it's a slightly opportunistic pathogen as well. But if you look back to right back at the beginning, I said to you that a lot of parasites don't want to kill their host. It's an accident if they do. But it's a good example of where you've got an imbalance of the immune system will cause a problem. I hope that answers your question, but come back to me if it doesn't. Right, I'm going to move on to, oh, this is just another little thing, just a bit of fun here, but this was a paper published quite a few years ago, but actually it was slightly tongue-in-cheek, but really what it was saying is because the parasite is so prolific across the world, it affects all the animals across the world, that if you wanted to get rid of extraterrestrial invaders, this would be your perfect biological weapon, because they would have no resistance to it. And it's back to that evolution, why do some parasites cause disease in some species and they don't in others? It's usually to do with co-evolution. Because the parasite it doesn't want to kill the host, it wants to use the host to get to its next stage. Right, the last bit you'll be pleased to hear. We're on to why parasites can be good for you after telling you horror stories. Right, parasites, how can parasites be beneficial? One thing I wanted to finish up with is talking here about parasitic worms. And again, this is to do with the fact that we probably all have lots of things living inside us that you don't want to know about. But certainly worms have evolved alongside us for a very, very long time. And the reason that worms are able to do this is they have worked out how to coexist with us really well because they have got mechanisms to slightly change our immune responses. Because a lot of worms will live inside our gut, and they use our gut as their home, and they get food and nutrients from us. And normally, if something comes in and invades you, the immune response will very quickly get worked to get rid of it. And the worms have got mechanisms where they can stop the immune response from attacking them and actually change the immune response to become beneficial to them. It's quite interesting. And if you look across, if you look at disease epidemiology across the world, in developed countries like ourselves, where we've got increased hygiene, public health measures, we've reduced worm burdens. And as a consequence of this, we've got quite high levels of allergic disease. And it's quite interesting, if you look across the world, going back in history, where they have gone in and dewormed people, you then see an equal increase of allergic disease occurring. And equally, in populations of people where there are a lot of parasitic worms, you really see allergic disease. And really, it's quite interesting. It's because the worms have developed ways of changing our immune responses to protect against allergic disease. And that's because the immune response that causes allergy, which is quite a big inflammatory response, is what the worm changes by using by stimulating a regulatory immune response. And understanding all of that, scientists have done a lot of work in looking at what are protective immune responses against worms, what are immune responses that would be called, used in or stimulated in allergic disease. And then wondered whether by understanding the host-parasite interaction, could you use that to develop better therapies for people suffering from allergic disease? And they did a very interesting experiment in Africa where they looked at some children that were infected with intestinal worms. They gave a tablet to the children to deworm them. Before they did that, they tested the children for a simple skin test to look for allergic responses, and they didn't pick up any while the children had worms. And when the children were dewormed, they went back in and did a skin test, which is quite a common test if you want to look for allergies. And following deworming, some of the children started to develop allergic responses. So the scientists then looking at, okay, can we use the worms to help us combat allergic disease? And they've been trialing some new therapies to treat allergies, autoimmune disorders. There's a few of them listed there in the slide. And there's been work done in two different places. In America, they've been using the pig whipworm, I think it is. That's a picture of the whipworm egg, second one down, where people have been asked to swallow worm eggs. And you'll probably be relieved to hear they weren't asked to swallow worms themselves, but just the worm eggs. And because it was a pig whipworm, which would not normally, we would not normally be, sorry, that worm would not normally be a host in people, it doesn't survive that long inside us. But it survives long enough to stimulate the immune response in the gut to become anti-inflammatory. So a lot of these allergic diseases are highly inflammatory. And what you want is something that will damp down that inflammatory response, and the worms do it really, really well. So what happens is people will swallow these whipworm eggs. It's a bit like taking your, probably some of you have taken Yakult or some of these probiotics. It's quite similar to that. You just take a small drink with the worm eggs in it. They hatch out, but they don't stay very long in your gut because we're not a natural host for them. But they do damp down the immune response. And they've had very, very good results with this in the States. In the UK, they've been looking at the picture above the worm egg is a hookworm, and that is a blood-sucking worm. And they've been looking at some trials down in Nottingham, using hookworm to help as therapies against some allergic diseases. They've also been interested in looking at the immunomodulation produced by the worms, which might be a way to help transplant patients not reject new allografts. So this whole area is a new area. There's a lot of really good research going on, both in Edinburgh and in other places in the world. And I think it's really nice and interesting research, because it's showing that by understanding, you know, how parasites have evolved to survive inside us, how they can change our immune responses, and if we can harness that in some way, you've almost got the perfect therapy against some of these, you know, really difficult diseases that a lot of people do suffer from. So I'm going to stop there. And just in summary of some things we've discussed this afternoon, I hope I've demonstrated or illustrated to you some examples of how parasites can be public enemy number one. They can be your new best friend. And I think in understanding the relationship of people and parasites or animals and parasites, you can use that information to hopefully create new ways of combating disease. What we've discussed is the important role of Scottish scientists and explorers in discovering a lot of the most important parasite diseases. The research about host-parasite relationships is really important in understanding immunity and how our immune systems cope with infection. And then how can we harness that knowledge to develop new therapies? An exciting one really is that parasites might be the answer to protect against allergic diseases. And an additional benefit is they will protect us against extraterrestrial invaders. So I hope that was interesting this afternoon, but I'm very happy to take any questions you might have.
Thank you, Nick. There's a question from Jennifer Codron. Well, there are actually two. One is about you and she perhaps having gone to school together at the same time. She said she was there from 1973 to 1978. So overlapped at some stage.
I think we would have done, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, her question is, she says, there must be a risk that the whipworm evolves to become more persistent in humans.
It could, except it's unlikely. The parasites do tend to be quite host specific, and what happens, I believe, with the whipworm is that it doesn't, because it's from pigs, it won't stay very long in your intestines. What happens is that people get it, I believe, they multiply a little bit in the gut, they stimulate the immune response to help protect against the, I think it's inflammatory bowel disease they were looking at, and then you would just, the worms would, they would die and would be expelled. I think that's why the scientists were going for the pig whipworm rather than a human worm, because you'd be absolutely right in that context. It was a human worm that would probably stay inside you. And that is the danger, I think, with some of these therapies, is that if you take the actual worm itself, yeah, you're introducing an infection. What the scientists are trying to do now is look at, is there some molecules or substances that the worms are producing that you could take and use as a therapy, which should be a lot safer. And that's where they're taking the research.
Okay, thank you very much. Alan, Lee and I will just move over there just to maybe have one or two of these questions, and then we'll wind up.
Okay. Just one or two questions, Amy. Thank you very much. One of the key aims of Morden is the promotion of animal health and welfare through research and education worldwide. And I was just wondering about the fact that conditions across the world vary greatly. And can you tell us a little bit about the challenges to your work in that regard?
Yeah, I mean, you know, you're absolutely right. I think if you were looking at diseases across the world, some of them are caused by differences in sanitation, differences in resources, nutrition, all sorts of things. So what you would probably look at in that regard is where is the best way to intervene for that particular country, population, you know, animals, whatever you're dealing with. You have to do it in the context of the country. You would have to also look at what was available there. For example, the vaccine we have for toxoplasma is a live vaccine and it requires a cold chain to deliver it. Therefore, the vaccine would work very effectively in Africa, but there's not that. It's difficult to get the cold chain, so we'd have to really look at the logistics of delivering that. So the context is very, very important, and you'll probably adjust your approach accordingly.
Okay, thank you. I was also wondering about the work perhaps that you do at Morden itself and the challenges you know, faced in the laboratory of studying parasites and their role in disease.
Yeah, I mean, we, you're right. But what we have to try and do in the lab, which can be quite tricky sometimes, is to reproduce the whole life cycle, the life cycle stages in the lab. And that can be, you know, that can be a problem. We're lucky at Morden is we have really, really good lab facilities and we have very good biological control facilities. So we are able, where we can, to reproduce, as far as we can, the different stages of the parasite in the lab. That really helps us when we're testing out vaccines or diagnostics or therapeutics, because you can test them out initially in vitro and see if that's working before you might go into a field trial.
Yeah.
But you have to also make sure that what you're working with is safe to work with. Some of these parasites you can catch, like toxoplasma and cryptosporidium. So we have to take extra precautions in the labs if it's something we can catch. It's easier working with things that maybe just affect the animals that you're not allowed to catch yourself. But it certainly helps having, we've got excellent facilities there, and we've got, at Morden we work very much interdisciplinary, so we have teams of immunologists, pathologists, geneticists, all working on one disease.
Yeah.
So you're able to apply quite a lot of input from different specialisms, with the outcome being creating a vaccine or diagnostic. And because at Morden we're owned by farmers, and we have farmers on our boards, and they tend to be very focused on getting an outcome that will help them control disease, and that helps direct our research, so we're very focused.
Thank you very much. I'm just going to say thank you to you today for coming along. I mean, it's been absolutely fascinating, and I'm sure that the teachers who've been watching today, and I believe I've got some students watching as well, will have found it very, very useful. Jackie Grockett from Craigmount High School sent in a question. She's obviously been very taken with the extraterrestrial story. And she's wondering if it would be possible to get a reference for that paper.
Yes,
that she could look at a little bit further with her.
Oh, of course. I mean, it was a bit of fun, I think, the person did it. But, you know, I think the message coming from that paper was it's all about the evolution of parasites. It's like War of the Worlds thing, where actually it was the bacteria who actually killed the aliens at the end of the day. Absolutely, I think this parasite would do the job as well, because there'd be no resistance. But I'll be very happy, I'll give the reference to Kate. You're very welcome to look at it.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, and thank you to everybody who's tuned in this afternoon. I'm going to ask Alan now, if you don't mind, to give us some feedback. Alan is going to put into the chat pod a link to a Survey Monkey, which it's quite a brief evaluation, but those of you who come in CERC courses will know that your evaluations, your opinions, what you say matters a great deal too. So just once again to thank Lee for a fascinating talk. It was just so nice to hear about the work of Scottish scientists, both in the past and now, you know, at the cutting edge of everything that's going on. So thank you so much for your time and your expertise.